Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. Welcome aboard the bus on our trip to the Eagle's Nest.
Hansi and Lotta and Magda and Fritz never got to see Hitler's Eagle's Nest, the Kellstein House. This was as much a secret from the majority of the people as was Eva Braun.
The road up to the Eagle's Nest is probably one of the most beautiful mountain roads in Germany and a great feat of engineering. It was built in as little as 3 years from 1936 to 1938.
The tour bus commentary by Lord Haw-Haw commends the speed of the road's construction, but neglects to mention the word slave. The book neglects similarly to mention the word genocide, but bangs on about the alleged crimes of the French regiment that liberated the place. But enough of that. Almost half a century after the end of Nazism, the official end, there is no unanimity about how to deal with the sites that were most holy to it. Whilst the party grounds at Nuremberg rot gracelessly, Hitler's Mountain Eyrie has become a place of pilgrimage, of Adolfolatry. And from here, on the highest peak in Germany, he could survey his domain, lose himself in visions or whatever. It's like the lair of a creature that is more than human, a thunderous Nibelung, a Teuton god of war. It's also like the treehouse of a mad child who believes that he can rule the world. The contrary form of infantile protostructure is the burrow, the warren, the uterine comforter. The Reich's leadership was obsessed by them and built them long before war made them actually necessary. These dark labyrinths are associable with secret societies and with the desire of humans to take on animal form. In war, soldiers and civilians alike had no choice but to behave like beasts. They were forever forgetting to observe the chasm that separates animals from humankind. They doubtless took inspiration from Himmler's assertion that Germans are the only people in the world who know how to treat animals properly, and from their beloved Führer's dictum that the Aryan is closer to the animal than he is to the Jew. Eventually, the nation that conducted itself like a disgusting zoo was obliged to scurry and burrow and hide in the dark. This fortress in Hamburg housed up to 50,000 people bombed out in the wake of the Allied air raids. It did its job. Direct hits dislodged anti-aircraft guns, but the 3-metre-thick walls and its 4-metre-thick roof held firm. The Third Reich's few original buildings, those which are aesthetically rather than historically momentous, belong to the architecture of belligerence and desperate defence. Even more sculpturally plastic forms were employed in the occupied Western territories, notably on Guernsey. Of course, these structures are utile, but they're also patently, if perhaps unwittingly, representational. Their imagery is unmistakable. They recall masks and visors and helmets and chainmail fists. These concrete gun emplacements and watchtowers form a link between the expressionism that the Nazis feared and so destroyed and the concrete brutalism of the 60s and 70s. London no doubt owes its South Bank to the Third Reich. Because of the enormity of its crimes, and because of the extent of those crimes, and because of the moral squalor which infected it, the Third Reich is regarded as some sort of aberration. 12 years when a supposedly civilized nation went mad.
It soothes us to think of it thus. It has certainly soothed subsequent generations of Germans, this exculpatory myth of collective madness.
Visit Dachau, the 1,200-year-old artist centre with its castle and surrounding park offering a splendid view over the country. The concentration camp at Dachau was opened 3 weeks after the Nazis took power. It was the first of 1,037 such camps.
Almost every town in Germany had a concentration camp. The idea that the ordinary Hansi in the street didn't know what was going on is as much a lie as the great myth that every German saved at least one Jew. You have to ask, why did they save them if they didn't know what was going on?
In addition to concentration camps, there were, by the end of the war, 7,000 forced labour camps. The Nazi regime was founded on slavery. Most of the buildings shown in this film were built by slaves.
Here is the master builder Albert Speer, and here he is consulting with members of his workforce.
Nazism's architecture is inseparable from the means of its construction. 32,000 people died in this place, starved, beaten, shot, experimented upon. It was, of course, not by its architecture, not by Speer's bloated temples, not by its creepy thatch cottages, that the 12-year Reich ensured that it would indeed last in human memory for the other 988 years. A German railway track entering a wood will forever mean mass death.